does.
Welcome to Dream Daddy. I'm your host, Lost Wolf. This is episode 25. We are busy doing the Robert dates. We're going to do date number 2. Indeed, we shall message him. I had a lot of fun with Robert that last time we hung out, but I'm beginning to wonder if he's dodging me. I tried messaging him a few times, and Dad Book says he hasn't even read them. I haven't even seen him come out of his house, actually. I decided to send him one last message, figuring this will produce the same result. Hey man, don't know where you've been, but we should grab a drink soon. I walk away from my computer because, at this point, I know he's not messaging me back anytime soon. I linger in the kitchen. I'm all caught up on work. We didn't know you worked. This is the first time we've ever seen him talk about work. The house is relatively clean. Maybe I should do something nice for Amanda. I'll bake her favorite pie. I root through the pantry and pull out the ingredients. This is an old family recipe that I used to make with my grandmother when I was a kid. I lost the actual recipe card a long time ago, but I think I'll be able to remember how to bake it. I stop mixing the ingredients together for the crust until I get a nice dough. I throw some cherries into a saucepan and make the filling. Normally I don't like to multitask in the kitchen, but this cherry pie is a piece of cake. Pie? It's a piece of pie. I'm making a pie. Ah man, I can never remember what temperature you're supposed to set the oven at. I'm pretty sure it's 375 degrees and that's probably Fahrenheit. It is probably indeed Fahrenheit, but I could be wrong. Who am I kidding? I'm never wrong when it comes to this pie. My special twist on my grandma's recipe includes a secret ingredient that not even Amanda knows about. It really makes the cherries extra flavorful. God, why can't I remember what the secret ingredient is? More cherries, salt, almond extract. I feel like more cherries wouldn't help. Salt is gonna be terrible. Who goes almond extract? Oh, it's almond extract. I accidentally poured a little too much in. Way too much in. I'm sure it's fine. Baking is an art, and some of the most beautiful art are made from mistakes. I finally get the pie in the oven. How long am I supposed to leave it in there? 50 minutes? Oh, I'll just wing it. Man, it's going to be so excited. That kid loves a good pie. I have a seat at the kitchen table and do word jumbles until Amanda comes home. I can hear the door slam open. Yo, Pops, what smells like pie in here? It's pie, sweetie. Amanda darts over to the oven and looks inside. Yes. Hey, it's not done. Be patient. Watch your angle here.
What?
Pie is an objective-based confection. What are you trying to get out of me? Fine, you caught me. Nothing. I've been leading a double life. Only ghost, I've been leading a double life. Amanda, I have terrible news for you. I'm actually a post-skateboarder and aspiring astronaut and bank robber. Lifestyle's calling me back. And I must go. One last job. You know how it is. This pie was the only way I knew how to tell you.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate the years we spent together, but a trade-up is a trade-up. Remember me when you're kicking your feet up in Ibiza. Thanks for all the pie. We show a cordial handshake. Wait a few more minutes before taking the pie out of the oven. I set it on the rack to cool. And God, it's so Amanda doesn't dig into it before it's ready.
Huh?
Huh? What? Does it look kind of weird to you? Oh, that's just me taking artistic license on what cherry pie means to me emotionally. I was saying this because, you know, it seems like you might have baked this pie incorrectly. And you're currently right now trying to pass it off as a good thing. It's art, sweetie. Was it art when you accidentally baked a whole uncracked egg into the center of my 12th birthday cake? Oh, no. Well, it's... Was it art when you tried to make brownies and I accidentally created... gas? Well, that's a bit of an exaggeration. Was it art when you... Just eat the pie, Panda. I cut us a few slices and we sit down to eat. The cherry filling oozes out of the sides and the buttery crust glistens. I watch as Amanda takes a bite. Ugh. What's wrong? Is it not good? Mm. Amanda winces and fans her mouth. No, no, I just burned the heck out of the roof of my mouth. The pie is amazing. Sorry for doubting. I breathe a sigh of relief and take a bite. She's right, the pie is pretty incredible, as it always is. I'm really proud of you making a pie without burning the new house down. I got a few dad tricks up my dad's sleeve. Maybe fathers aren't as bumbling and stupid as the media make us out to be. Maybe we as a society should have a little more respect for fathers as a whole. Dad, your sleeve is on fire. I went to the sink and put myself out. Pie will be on my end doing. Man, did I clean up in the kitchen and play a little more living room hoops before she retreats to her room to do homework. I go back to my word jumbles. Hey, this one spells cat. Interesting. It kept the continuity where I found the hoop and we ended up shooting some basketball? I'm so bad with sport. The rest of the evening trickles by. We eat dinner, I help Amanda with one of her scholarship applications. We both start getting ready for bed. I decide to check Dad book one last time before I climb into bed. Still nothing from Robert. Hope he's okay. I turn out the lights and lie down. Hey. Alex? Hey. Hey, Alex. Hey, I'm outside. Come outside. What is that? I was just on the verge of falling asleep. I climb out of bed and try to identify the source of the ding. My computer screen illuminates the dark room. I walk over to it, ready to turn it off when I notice what's happening on screen. Don't make me honk. I will honk. Get out here. I look out my window and sure enough, there's Robert leaning up against his pickup truck in my driveway. I open my door to try and figure out what's going on. Hey. Hey? Wanna hang? Oh, sorry. I was kind of sleeping. That's no fun. Come hang out. I would argue that sleeping is very fun, but I don't have to be anywhere in the morning. Might as well live a little. Sure. Cool. You plan on going out like that? I look down and realize that I am in fact not wearing pants. I mean, I don't mind. Right, one second. I went inside and throw on my going out pants, shoes, and a jacket. I grab my keys and meet Robert back outside. Ready? Ready. Hop in. I jump into the passenger seat of his old red pickup truck. I have to move a few empty cigarette packets and gas station receipts out of the way before I can sit. Robert silently starts the car and we drive out of the cul-de-sac. You like Tom Waits? Love Tom Waits. Tom who? Waste that rag, baby. This is a song lyric, I believe, which is a little bit better than Love Tom Waits. This is you being, I don't know what you're talking about. So we're going to go with that. Before I can answer, Robert turns up the radio. Yep, that's Tom Waits, alright. He lights a cigarette and cracks the windows. We drive together in silence. So where are we going? Robert doesn't respond. Robert? Oh, I heard you. He still doesn't answer my question. I look out the window and notice that Robert's taking us up the highway. I twiddle my thumbs. Well, whatever he's got myself into. Looks like I'm in it for the night. Settle into my seat and watch street lights go by. I glance over to Robert, who's driving intently. He looks tired, as he always does, but there's something a bit more here, there, that I just can't place. Are you okay? I like your car. Say nothing. Okay, so, this is a cadence thing, like I keep saying. In Robert's case, sometimes silence is the best option. Because, like he said in the bar, and he's correct, people don't put enough stock in silence. So, we're going to go with say nothing. I remember what Robert said about hating small talk and decided to keep my mouth shut. He notices me staring. Stop looking so nervous. I'm not nervous. I'm a little nervous. Just hang on, we're almost there. Almost where? I have no idea where we are. I think we're moving at a slight incline, but I'm not so sure. We eventually come to a stop. Robert gets out of the car and I sit for a second. I'm sure if he wants me to get out too. What are you waiting for? I hastily exit the car. Robert sits in the bed of his truck and pats the space next to him. I sit down and take in the view. We were on a hill overlooking the city skyline, against the bay. The cool night air rustles some trees near us. As the lights blink in the distance, off to the side, I can see an entrance to a dense forest. That is actually a cool bit of art. I am basically a night owl, and this is the kind of thing I love as well. Man is also gorgeous. This is where I come to masturbate. What? I'm kidding. What's wrong with you? This is my little spot where I come to think. It's nice. You can see the whole city from up here. Really gives you some perspective. Hobbit reaches behind him and pulls something out from under his jacket. It glints in the moonlight, and I suddenly realize what it is. Oh shit, that's a knife. Oh, please don't stab me. Hobbit reaches into his pocket and pulls out a small piece of wood. Please don't stab me with that either. Robert takes a knife to the piece of wood and starts carving. Oh, I breathe a very audible sigh of relief as Robert looks at me sideways. Did you think I was going to stab you just now? What? No. I hate to break it to you, but I did in fact bring you out here to harvest your organs. Laugh. Play along. So, again, this is a cadence thing. This is the kind of humor that Robert is basically set up for, so we're going to play along because that's part of the extended joke that's happening here. Yeah, well, you think you caught me in your trap, but I knew. For years I've been putting the most vile junk food in my body in preparation for this day. Come at me, friend, and reap what you will. Two step ahead of you at all times. That's how I find. Nothing gets past you, huh? Oh, reaches into his pocket and pulls out a folding knife that he opens and hands to me. I am gonna warn you, the last guy I had a knife fight with lost three fingers because he didn't know the 8 basic rules of knife fighting. You're familiar, correct? I honestly can't tell when you're kidding. I'm so many levels of irony deep that I've forgotten what humor is. He and I laugh. Have you ever whistled before? Considering I'm not a grandpa, no. What do you mean by that? Well, I just thought that you would have a block of wood shipped to you, along with your first social security check. Wow, that's almost a backhanded slap at Robert. Alex, I'll have you know that whittling is a time-honored tradition enjoyed by both young and old alike. That you're dismissing it before you even try to speak volumes about your character. However, because I've gotten to know you, he is not wrong, by the way. Because I've gotten to know you for some time and have come to think of you as us friends, I'm willing to attribute it to ignorance instead of malice. What I'm trying to say is, go get that stick. Oh, it motions to a good-looking stick in the ground, perfect for potential whittling. I pick it up. The most important thing to remember while whittling is to cut with the grain, not against it. If you cut against the grain, the wood is going to splinter. Isn't the most important thing safety? No. Getting hurt comes with the territory. Look at my damn hands. I look at his damn hands. They're calloused and covered in little white scars. They are very nice hands. You can't make a stick omelette without breaking a few hand eggs. Oh, I forgot to save. Knife that wood. Made a pencil. That's a good start. What is it? A sharp stick, a pencil, a knitting needle. It looks to me like it's a pencil. Good luck writing with that. Highly dangerous. You made a highly dangerous weapon. tell me about this one. Popsicle stick time to press a flat one. It looks to me, well, I can't rotate it anymore, but it looks like a popsicle stick to me. Now all you need is to cover some wooden juice, wooden fruit, and a wooden freezer. Oh, I did, in fact. Completely again. And again. I wonder what I'm going to make out of this one. Oh goodness, it's a very tiny pencil. A toothpick, a bubble popper. Something to make me look tougher. A toothpick. It looks like a toothpick. You realize that you could have just picked your teeth with a knife. Okay. Less. A chicken nugget, I don't know. A Ouija board planchette. I'll go with a chicken nugget. Please don't eat that. You made Robert uncomfortable. Oh, very good. Let's cut just the bottom off. Oops. I didn't mean for that to happen. What I kind of want to do is get rid of that obstruction over there. Oops. A self-portrait of Louisiana. It's you. Let's go. I don't know if it is Louisiana. Good old Louisiana. Beautiful place. Got stabbed there once, you know. Or was it Kentucky? You made a Louisiana. Let go of the knife. What I really want to do is want to try and cut the very top off there. I guess not. Okay. Nope. I am not going to get the very top off. I'm trying to make a house, but I guess that's just not going to work. Interesting. What do we have here? Chopstick right, chopstick left, chopstick. Ambidextrous. I'm gonna go with that. It's a stick. Oh goodness. It's interesting, though, that the blocks are different sized. That wasn't a thing I was expecting out of this particular minigame. I want to cut a little more off here, there. Maybe he just put off the top. There we go. like this configuration of stuff happening at the top there. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and, although I don't think I'm going to get it right, I'm going to try and get rid of, yeah, that doesn't work, alas. A swan, a duck, a new friend. Yeah, I guess that's, you can see it, he's beautiful. I'm happy for you. You made a new friend. It looks more like a duck. Looks a bit like a tank, actually, just from the bit we've cut away so far. If I could cut the top off, I could probably get it to be like a tank. Oh goodness. Beautiful handiwork. What do you call it? Big old dog, the spirit of the Mustang. Saw Horsington the Brave. Actually, I like that. A brave and noble name for a brave and noble creature. A beautiful gift for Amanda. Oh, that's kind of sweet. If you'll remember, Saw Horsington the Brave was a thing that she was into when she was a lot younger. She made him up and all that kind of thing. Robert and I sit in silence for a while, carving out pieces of wood. I think I'm getting the hang of this. It's actually kind of relaxing. I glance over to see what Robert's working on. He's carving a smaller wooden knife. Ah! While I'm distracted, the knife slices into my thumb. Blood gushes all over my little wooden carving. Robert is lost in carving and doesn't notice me bleeding everywhere. Robert still doesn't notice. Robert, I'm dying. I'm bleeding to death. Robert finally looks over. He reaches into his jacket again. Jesus. How much stuff does this guy keep in there? And pulls out a red bandana. He wraps it around my thumb. Hold tight. He hops off the truck, and I can hear him rummaging around in his car. He comes back a moment later with a well-stocked first aid kit. Robert carefully wipes all the blood off my hand, and swipes a bit of antiseptic into the cut. With surprising gentleness, he places a bit of gauze on the wound, and wraps it all up. You okay? Yeah, I'm good. He hands me what's left of the tube of antiseptic. Make sure to keep that cut clean. It's oddly touching and a little sexy. I guess I'm a real whittler now. At you, I'll be careful though. They're attracted to the smell of blood. Wait, what's attracted to the smell of blood? Cryptids. Tons of them out here, you know. Cryptids? Like Mothman and stuff? Mothman is bullshit, but yeah. This town is a hotbed for cryptozoological occurrences. You're joking. Oh, how I wish I were. I'm a skeptic myself, or at least I thought I was. There are things in these woods that we can't possibly comprehend. I think about my entire time in the city, aside from the occasional stray coyote, I don't think it's too bad. You ever heard of the Dober Ghost? I don't think so. Well, let me tell you a story. I was out in the woods here on a weekend camping trip with Betsy. You don't know Betsy, but she's a big pup. Pitbull. Real intimidating. I feel safe around her. First night goes to that incident. I get some solitude. Betsy gets to pee wherever she wants. All good stuff. Second day, I get the idea into my head that I can hike deeper into the woods. Probably against my better judgment, but hey, we're just having a fun camping trip, right? So, me and Betsy start marching in the morning. It gets a little late and we set up camp, but it's different this night. Real quiet. I can't hear the birds, the crickets, squirrels, nothing. Dead silent. Then it happens. I hear the most unholy growl I've ever heard in my life. Right outside my tent. Me and Betsy, we go to investigate. We look around the clearing. Nobody's there. But there's this feeling. Not sure if I can quite describe it. I know someone, something, is watching us. Betsy, though, she's scared. Never seen her like that. When she's scared, I know what I should be too. And then I see it, in the distance. A man, but if something that didn't know what a man was supposed to look like. It just looked wrong. Big, arms long for its body. Black eyes. It just stood there and stared at me. Then it disappears. I hear one yell from Betsy, and I turned around to check on her. But she's gone. Into thin air. I didn't sleep at all in my tent that night. And I don't think I've slept right since. That's terrible. You're lying. I'm gonna go with you're lying. Because of course we're going to be as skeptical about Robert's stories as, you know, he started off sounding. Okay, you're full of shit. You think I'm lying? Robert pulls out his wallet and shows me a picture of a beautiful football. Tell that to Betsy. They said if you listen closely on quiet nights, nights just like tonight, you can hear the howls of Dover Ghost. A howl resonates through the woods. It doesn't sound like a regular howl. It's so guttural. Even from far away, something about it makes my skin crawl. Okay, Robert, real funny. I turn to look at Robert. He's white as a sheet. You're messing with me, right? I was messing with you. Up until literally just now, I totally made that camping story up. I strained my eyes to scan the forest line, trying to see where the howl originated from. Off in the distance, I see something. It's so far away, I barely can make out a shape. It looks human, but it's dragging something? Do you see that? We should go. Robert and I slowly back away and get into the truck. He turns off his headlights and we make a slow crawl away, back onto the road. I'm too scared to look back. What was that? The Dover Ghost, I guess. I chuckle nervously. This time he doesn't seem like he's messing with me. Or maybe someone illegally dumping garbage in a wildlife preserve? Yeah, that's the story we'll tell ourselves. We sit in silence for a little while longer. The fear of whatever that was slowly subsiding as we get close to the city. Thanks for coming out. This was fun. I'm sorry I haven't been in touch. I've just been in a way lately. I had to get out of the house. I had to be around somebody. You doing okay, man? Robert thinks for a second and lights another cigarette. I've been doing a lot of thinking. He takes a long drag. As I get older, I feel more and more that I'm just drowning in the sea of regret. I was so busy chasing after these things that I thought would make me happy that I didn't think about anyone else. All I cared about was myself. I didn't even think. Robert stops. I wait for him to finish his thought, but he just stares at the road. Maybe I just bolt like this. Or maybe I'd do it to myself. Maybe it's my own choice that I'm as unhappy as I am. I try to think of something to say. I remember all the times in my life where I've been sad, and there's a great many of them, but there was always a light at the end of the tunnel, something I held on to that kept me going. But there's something so resigned about the way Robert's talking. That sucks. I'm glad you told me. Maybe we deserve to be eaten by that Dover Ghost. This is silly, and it dismisses his feelings. This is silly in a way, because basically it takes what he's saying and then sort of says, you know, well, what can anyone do? But this is the right thing in this situation for this person. Because he needs someone. That's why he came out. So, we will go with us. It must have taken a lot for you to want to tell somebody this. You're a mysterious guy, Robert. You don't have to be. Do you ever wish you were a better father? I think about it for a second. All the time. You can read all the parenting books you want, but nothing will ever prepare you for raising a child. So much stuff I regret or wish that I could have done better. But I don't have the answers. I don't know if anyone does. It's funny. I look at you and your relationship with your daughter, and it seems perfect. It isn't. At least you're there for her. I stare out the window at the blur of passing trees. I just hope I'm a better father for my kid than my dad was to me. What did your dad do? It's more about what he didn't do. He was quiet, stoic. Don't think he ever once told me that he loved me. He cared more about his work than he ever did about me or my mom. Do you hate him? No, I used to, but after I became a parent, I just kind of feel bad for him. You missed out on my whole childhood. When I think about all of the happiest moments of my life, they're all with Amanda and Alex, and he just wasn't there. It hurt like hell when I had to leave him to die in the Bulasaurian prison. Huh? What? I turned and smiled at him. No, he's retired in Florida with my mom. We go there every Christmas. We both break out into laughter. He pats me on the shoulder. We drive the rest of the way in silence, listening to the radio and watching the bright lights of the city grow bigger. Robert drops me off at my place. As I'm about to close the passenger door, I realize that I still have Robert's pocket knife in my jacket. Pull it out and offer it back to him. You hold on to that. Never know when you might need it. Night, Robert. Have a safe drive home. Robert smirks, then pulls away. He then immediately pulls into his driveway, which is one over from mine. He gets out and waves. I tiptoe into the house, careful not to wake Amanda. Whoa, where'd you come from? I look around and spot Amanda coming out of the kitchen with a glass of water. I thought he was sleeping. Robert woke me up to go cryptid hunting. You know the Mothman is bullshit, right? Amanda language. You know what? It's fine. I think about the conversation I had with Robert in the car as Amanda starts walking towards the room. Hey, Amanda? She stops. I love you. Aww. It's weird when you say it outright and sincerely like that, but I love you too. Night. I chuckle to myself and finally decide to go to bed. I guess if you want to look at it, my dad and Robert's dad are probably baby boomers. In this particular situation, I want to say that given that Amanda's 18, and given that my character probably knew his significant other for a couple of years before he actually adopted Amanda, I think that was what we chose, it is probably a good bet to say that he was a Gen Xer, because that's the 1980s, and so his parents were probably baby boomers. Handyman for Whittling, of course, whiskey for Robert, crime. We don't know that there was crime, we're just, you know, sort of wildly speculating. We did use a knife. I don't understand why this is not higher, but it's not, and we did a lot of whittling. Well, it's been a long day. I'm just about ready to pack it in. After a few bites of ice cream from the freezer, I turn off all the lights and walk down the hall to my room. I wonder if Amanda's still awake. The kid needs some sleep. It's a possible I can hear a faint sound, but I can't quite make out what it is. Get a little closer. Is she crying? I knock gently on the door. Hey, Amanda? The crying immediately stops. Not right now. Her voice sounds strange. She sniffles. I need to make sure she's okay. I open the door. In the dark, I can see Amanda's outline in the middle of her bed, knees hugged up against her body. Is everything okay? I don't want to talk about it. Did something happen? Leave her alone. Did something happen? No, nothing happened. Go away. Something must have happened. Amanda, get out. Okay, okay. I quickly leave her room and shut the door behind me. Once the door closes, I can hear her crying again. Wow. What is her so upset? She seemed fine earlier. She's usually so open with me. Did I do something wrong? Was she mad at me? I guess if she wasn't before, she definitely is now. I can't even remember the last time she snapped at me like that. I have a hard time falling asleep, but when I finally do, I'm still thinking about Amanda. After a long night of very little sleep, I roll into bed and make myself a pot of coffee. Amanda should be up for school soon. Maybe she'll be willing to talk about whatever's bothering her. Huh? About 10 minutes before she's supposed to leave, Amanda comes out of her room and makes a beeline for the freezer. Morning, Amanda. Morning. She drops a frozen waffle into the toaster and slams the freezer door. She won't look at me. Yikes. So, anything big going on at school today? Aww. Nope. Okay. Do you need a ride to school? Nope. Want some coffee? Amanda pulls the toaster lever up and takes her slow freezer burnt waffle. up before it's finished cooking. I have to go. Amanda picks up a bag and storms out. Mm-hmm. Okay. I haven't seen her act like this in a long time. It's usually short-lived, but it always hurts. Hopefully this blows over and things are back to normal soon. I sit back at the kitchen table and look at the picture of Amanda and I hanging on the wall. In it, I'm teaching her to ride a bike. Her face is a mixture of excitement and pure unadulterated fear. I remember how determined she was. Every time she would fall off and scrape her knees, she would get up and try again. Finally, I had to stop her because she was bleeding everywhere. Then she started to cry because she didn't think she needed bandages and wanted to keep trying. As I put the bike away, she just stood in the middle of the street and screamed. Then I took off ice cream. It was like nothing even happened. After giving it a bit of thought, I decided if I force her to talk about it, I'm going to make things worse, but I have an idea. I start rummaging around for ingredients. I hear Amanda walk in the door instead of heading for the kitchen like she usually does. She makes a beeline to her room. She's clearly trying to avoid me. Hey, pumpkin?
What?
Can you come here for a sec? There's a moment of silence.
Yeah.
I wanted to say sorry about last night. I'm just worried about you, kiddo. I get scared when I know something's wrong, and I get even more scared when I feel like I can't do anything about it.
Dad,
So I just... Whatever it is, and you don't have to tell me if you don't want to. Whatever it is, you just know that you have a dad in your corner who wants you to be happy.
Mm-hmm.
Honey, you know I'm bad with words, so something I could speak a language we both understand. I pull a cake out of the refrigerator and place it on the table. Hopefully the frosting is set by now. Ta-da! Dad. It took me a really long time because I ran into red frosting somewhere and sad and had to start over.
Yeah.
This is beautiful. It's strawberry. Amanda gives me a big old hug. I grab some plates and forks and service up some delicious cake. So, it's really stupid.
What is?
This whole thing, I mean, I know I've been really weird lately and there's just... I don't even know how to explain it. I feel like I might have to make you a chart. I'm listening. Do you want me to take notes?
No.
I guess I should start from the top. So, you know how MR is going to that fancy art school in California, right? MR... The best friend?
Yeah.
You got it? Wow, proud of you.
Yeah.
Anyways, ever since she got the acceptance letter, I've been feeling like she's drifting away, you know? And she's been spending a lot more time with Grace and MP. I just thought it was all in my head for a while, but then I found out from Rosie M that both of them, as Grace and Noah, all went to a party at Mackenzie F's. On the same night, they all told me they were busy studying for the Calc AB final. Yikes. So, another important part of piece of information is... Oh, God. This is embarrassing. I am... Have a crush on Noah, and, that's the thing.
What?
Whoa. I had no idea. I definitely didn't know that. Okay. You're a bad liar. So are you. I learned from the worst.
Oh, no.
Anyway, so the only person I told about the crush is MR, and she promised not to tell anybody. I didn't confront them about the party thing, because I didn't want to start drama. So I just keep quiet and keep going about my business. Amanda sighs. And then one day I invite everybody out to get nachos at the mall, and after not texting me back for like 2 hours, even though none of them ever put down their phones more than 60 seconds, they all say they're busy, like, simultaneously. So I tell them, never mind, I'll just eat nachos at home, right? But we were out of chips and I really, really wanted nachos. Totally understandable. So I go to the mall anyway, I get to the food court, and who do I see there but Grace, Emma, P, Emma, R, and Noah, all hanging out together and eating nachos. Without me?
What?
It gets better, I'm standing by the escalators watching them, and I realize that Noah has his arm around Emma, R, which is kind of weird, right?
But then they kiss.
No. Yes, I know. So storm over there, I'm like, hey! And Grace drops the nacho over the ship, because of course she does, and MR just like glares at me. Grace, Grace. Nothing is coming up. I don't know who that is. Grace is the gossipy one.
Yeah.
I know! Grace is the one nobody really likes, or I guess that's me now. But anyway, nobody will say nothing, and I'm just like, you guys suck. Which I realize is not the most eloquent thing to say, but I was very angry. Really embarrassed, I just wanted to get out of there. So saw that without notice my dad, which only further contributed to the shitty day, and immediately dropped a super long text to the group chat asking them why they've been so weird. And I wrote another one to MR asking how long the other thing's been going on, and sorry, I know that's a lot. Useful following? What did MR say? I'm a little confused, but I think I understand. I have no idea what's happening. These two are alright. This is not a good idea. Oh, okay. Gonna load this. MR says, you know what? Let me just read it to you. Amanda pulls out her phone and reads word for word an obviously wrong string of text messages. Can you believe it? I can believe that. I cannot believe that. I care so much about Amanda's social life and mental well-being, but man, do I not understand what she's talking about. This is all beyond me, but I'm trying my hardest to be supportive. Mm-hmm. They were dating in secret for like months. So I told her that she's being a really terrible friend, and she's like, well, if you think I'm so terrible, then just stop being my friend. I was like, okay, and then she left me unread, and then, wait, left me unread? What's that? Oh, like, she saw my message and didn't reply, and I know because there were red receipts. I don't know what red receipts are, but I'm just gonna nod and pretend I understand. Gotcha. So, while this is all happening, I'm talking to Emma P and about how mad I am because she's at least being kind of reasonable, and I'm venting to her about how pissed I am at everybody and stuff. And then, I don't know where no one texts me, is like, how could you say that about me? I'm like, say what about you? And he tells me that Emma P sent screenshots of everything I told her to the group chat I got kicked out of. Alright, I think you lost me in screenshots, but that definitely sounds bad.
Mm.
It's so much more, but honestly, it's all just really stupid teenager stuff. The bottom line is that everybody dropped me, half my grade hates me, and now I have no friends. Amanda, I'm so sorry. I almost expected it from everybody else, but MR's been there since Dad died. I can't believe she would just stab me in the back like that. I'm not even mad that she's dating Noah, I'm just upset that she lied to me about it for so long. Amanda stabs at the remnants of her cake. Okay, I take it back, I'm kinda mad she's dating Noah. Like, what did I do wrong? Why did everyone just suddenly decide I'm not cool anymore? Why wasn't I enough? I don't understand. As bad as I am at everybody, like, I miss them, Dad. Amanda looks so dejected I almost can't take it. What could I possibly say to help?
Oh.
Anyways, that's it. That's the whole sort of tale. Thanks for listening. Tune in next week for more hot gossip. Wow. I know it's pretty dumb. It's kind of dumb. It's not dumb. She's a teenager. She's having feelings. Everybody has feelings. Her feelings are not dumb. No, it's a stupid thing to be upset over. Amanda, your feelings are real. Don't ever be mad at yourself for having feelings. I guess. Unless you've secretly been a robot who's been approximating human feelings this whole time. Dad, if I was a robot, I would have transformed into a monster truck a long, long time ago. But seriously, I know you probably don't want advice, but I feel like it's my duty as a dad to bestow upon you a few nuggets of fatherly wisdom. Not all friendships last forever. Real friends don't do that, and high school sucks. I feel like she would know this by now at 18. You've been through a couple of friendships. You may not necessarily understand the whys or wherefores why those friendships broke up, and you may not be accepting of it, but you understand at this point that that has happened. High school sucks. It's not a thing that she needs to hear. She is going through high school right now, and she knows this pretty well, but this is a thing that maybe she hasn't quite realized yet. When you get older, you start realizing the sort of people you want to associate yourself with. Do you really want to surround yourself with people who would do something like that to their friend? It takes a lot of work to find and maintain meaningful friendships. It took me a long time to figure that out myself, and I wish I had learned it sooner. If the other person isn't putting the effort in to show you how much they care, it's not worth it. You're not beholden to being their friend. Ultimately, I think this is more about their character than it does about yours, because you're amazing, and if they can't see it, well, that's their problem. I'll keep that in mind. I looked down at the table. Did we just eat the whole cake? Yes, we did just eat that whole cake. Well, good talk. Amanda gets up to go to her room. Before she closes the door, she turns around. Hey, Pops? Yes. Thank you. You're always welcome. Love you, Amanda.
I love you too, Dad.
I love you too, Dad. You've got dads. And that's us for today. There's gonna be an intermediate video where I do a very quick side thing. But tomorrow we will do the end of the Robert line, and that will be that. That will be us done with Dream Daddy. Thank you so much for watching. I've been your host, Lostwolfe, as always. This has been episode 25 and Robert's second date for Dream Daddy. I hope I see you all tomorrow. Have a wonderful evening, and good night for now.